ज्योतिर्गमय मृत्योर्मा अमृतं गमय। ओम शांति शांति शांति। नमस्ते एवरीवन एंड वेलकम टू टुडेज फर्स्ट सेशन ऑन केनोपनिषद। आई होप आई एम क्लियरली ऑडिबल टू ऑल ऑफ यू। And today we are going to start a new Upanishad, the Kenopanishad, which is very, very, very interesting. The introduction, an introduction to the Upanishads, I have already given you when I started Ishavasya Upanishad. So I will not go into that kind of an introduction again, but let me tell you how important these ideas are. They are to do directly with what is called self-development. Because what are they trying to do? What's the subject matter of the Upanishad? It's the self, the unchanging core of our existence. So when you discover that, the entire equipment, the mind, the body, the senses, your perceptions, mentations, everything, you are able to control, you are able to grasp, you are able to experience things. See, experience is always in the first person. So then you are able to find out the core reality about all of these things, how they function. So putting you in charge of yourself, that is why Vivekananda would say that the Upanishads are the very mine of strength. They give you this immense strength, they put you on your own feet. You see, the very concept, the very thought that I am not merely the body and mind, I am the soul which enlivens this body and mind. This itself puts you into a kind of objective perception of the body-mind complex. So then you can handle it. It puts a distance between you and your thought, you and your senses. So you can handle them objectively. So this is the beauty of this knowledge. And who would not want to know the unchanging reality about himself? Isn't it? So this is the glory of this literature. Even on the last day of Vivekananda's life, in 1902, 4th July, Vivekananda insisted that the Vedas and the Upanishads have to be studied. In fact, he told one of his brother disciples, Swami Premananji, on that day, that I want a Vedic school established where students will be taught the Vedas. And Premananji asked, but why the Vedas? And Vivekananda said, it will kill superstition. So you see, superstition, mystery mongering, narrow dogmas, all this will be removed if you penetrate into the heart of reality. This is a science, actually speaking. These Upanishads, it's the science of consciousness. It has nothing to do with any dogma. It has nothing to do with any doctrine. It has nothing to do with any belief system. It is not an ideology. It is not somebody's idea. It is a penetration into the heart of our being, into existential reality, and a scientific penetration made possible by sadhana, by spiritual practice. So then it will nothing but strengthen you from within. The beauty of the Upanishad is actually this. It puts you on your own feet. And any kind of superstition or wrong thinking will naturally dissolve. It will be removed as a result of this penetration. So that is why Vivekananda used to say, the Upanishads are an infinite mine of strength. In them lies strength enough to invigorate the whole world. The whole world can be energized by this strength. So this is the beauty of this Upanishadic literature, and we should be able to penetrate into it in the first person. I'm telling you, you're hearing these talks, please don't stop with that. This is just the initial step. You must feel the reality of this in your own system through clarified thought, through inner stillness, and you will understand the relevance of the Upanishads. They are ever relevant. They are never irrelevant, for the simple reason they are talking about your unchanging being, that which, the only thing which never changes. So, and this is a complete self-exploration. You see, that's the beauty of the whole thing. It is said in one of the Upanishads that, you see, sages like Yajnavalkya, many people came forward to oppose their views, to have a kind of dialogue with them, but because they stood on the platform of realization, they had felt the truth of this in their own system, so they could easily handle all of this. And the truths they gave us, they live for all time, isn't it? They are beyond the boundaries of time, space. You see, across the oceans, they are being studied. For the simple reason, it is the truth of life. It is the science of consciousness. It is not a dogma. There's nothing narrow about it. Upon this are based a lot of philosophical systems. Sanatana Dharma is based on this science of consciousness, and that is why it accepted Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. The whole world is actually one family. So the common factor to all of us is consciousness, and the science of consciousness is Vedanta. The technology of consciousness, you can say, is yoga. It provides you very expert methods to dive into this science. So this is the beauty of this literature, and this is how it should be taken, as you would take up a scientific subject. Like that you should take and study it. Today we are going to dive into Kena Upanishad. Kena Upanishad comes from the Samaved. This is a very beautiful Ved, you know, which has to do with, you can chant it wonderfully. Samaveda hymns make beautiful chants. And this Kena Upanishad gets its name from the opening mantra. Just like Ishavasya Upanishad, you remember Ishavasya Upanishad began with Ishavasyam idam sarvam yatkincha jagatyam jagat. So that's how it got its name, Ishavasya Upanishad. Kena Upanishad also begins similarly. It begins with Keneshitam patati preshitam manaha. So Kena is the first word, so the Upanishad is called Kena Upanishad. Now, before we enter into this Upanishad, and the very first mantra is stunning, I'm telling you, let me give you an introduction to the main subject matter of this Upanishad, a kind of outline. You know, this Upanishad tracks down everything that you would want to know about conscious perception, the very source of conscious perception. It is tracking down. It is zeroing in on the fact of conscious experience. So actually, you see, this study was made, this Upanishad is at least 5,000 years old. And what we are today calling the heart problem of consciousness studies, which means how exactly the first person experience takes place. What gives me an experience of vividity and a complete first person experience, subjective experience in real time and space of the objects around me? This very question is being dealt with in this Upanishad, and they are providing answers to it. So it is very contemporary. It is very, very relevant to our present times, and especially in neurophysiology and consciousness studies. You see, these very ideas are coming up, and research is going on along these lines. So that is why you see there are consciousness studies departments across universities all over the world. In many universities, they are introducing these departments because of the relevance of the fact of consciousness. That is the basic substratum of life. So this Upanishad is directly dealing with that. Isn't it interesting? Tell me, it's the most interesting study possible. So we will be going into this conscious perception, how it takes place. What is consciousness then? How it is the ultimate reality of life, Brahman? And what are the factors that make it possible? So you will find very, very beautiful ideas, clear ideas on attention, awareness, mindfulness, and of course the process of conscious perception, not exactly the epistemology, but the source of conscious perception. How exactly conscious perception and attention are responsible for our experience of life. So you find such stunning ideas being discussed here If this Upanishad, just imagine, it's actually like a conversation between a disciple and a guru, a teacher. But the names of the disciple and the teacher are not given in the Keno Upanishad. This is the beauty of this literature. They never left behind their signature because they were so detached. Reality, truth has to be grasped as it is. And they did not claim any copyright. They did not indulge in anything of this for the research they have conducted. And the lab is right here. Even you can perform this research. Anybody who asks this profound questions by himself will open up the way to the answer. So that is how we are going to study this Keno Upanishad. Let me start with the peace chant, the Shanti Mantra. I had told you every Upanishad has a particular peace chant, and Keno Upanishad has this chant, this particular invocation. Om Aapyayantu Mamangani Vak Pranas Chakshu Shrotra Matho Balam Indriyani Cha Sarvani Sarvam Brahma Upanishadam Maham Brahma Nirakuryam Mama Brahma Nirakarod Anirakaranamastu Anirakaraname Astu Tadatmani Nirateya Upanishadsu Dharmaste Maisantu Te Maisantu Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. We will go word by word, what it means. It's a very powerful invocation. The preparation to make such a profound research is that my limbs should be strong, my mental capacity should be strong. So this is a prayer for that. Please observe. Om Aapyayantu Mamangani. It means may all my limbs, angani, grow strong. Vak prana chakshu shrotra matho balam indriyani cha sarvani. All of my pran, my vital energy, the breath, my speech, eyes, ears, and all my organs, may they all become strong, firm, so that I may undertake this research. Sarvam brahma upanishadam. All is Brahman of which the Upanishads speak. Maham Brahma Nirakuryam. May I never deny this Brahman. See, it's a very important prayer. May I never deny reality. May my buddhi never become so corrupt that it does not want to penetrate into the truth of life. And then he says, Mama Brahma Nirakarod. And may Brahman never deny me. May Brahman never turn me away. May the reality never escape me. So committed may my research be. Then, Mama Brahma Nirakarod Anirakarana Mastu. Anirakarana me astu. Let there be no turning away on either side. May I not deny Brahman, nor may Brahman never deny me. Nor should Brahman ever turn away from me, which means to say, let me open the path to reality. Let my buddhi become so refined, so subtle and pure that I am able to intuit the truth as it is. May I never create these blocks in my mind which turn me away from the truth. Then he says, I am engaged in the study of the self. Tadatmani nirateya upanishadsu. The Upanishads speak of these qualities. I am engaged in the study of the Upanishad. And dharmaste mai santu te mai santu. The qualities that the Upanishad speaks of, the divine qualities that one should possess, which we have already discussed in our discussions on sadhana, those qualities may I possess. And may I succeed in this study by acquiring those qualities. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Om Peace Peace Peace. Let there be peace internally. Let there be peace externally. Let there be peace in the celestial worlds. So that my research may be fruitful. My study may be fruitful. So that I realize the knowledge of Brahman. I realize the ultimate truth about life. So this is the starting opening prayer of the Rishi and his students, that let everything in me be strengthened, that my study and this research is fruitful. So you see, it's a beautiful prayer, because please understand the gravity of this knowledge. Unless we understand that, we will not know why the Upanishads were insisted upon by all the great men in our land. Why is it that they said that this is the basis of everything else that has come out of here? Because the Upanishads are the very quintessence of the knowledge of the Vedas. And that is why the prayer begins like this. May my research, it's a personal research, you see, which each one of us has to carry out, may that be fruitful. So the entire system, may it be strengthened from within. This is the prayer. Now, let's go to the first mantra. Om keneshitam patati preshitam manaha, kena prana prathama praiti yuktaha, keneshitam vachamimam vadanti, chakshu shrotra kau devo yunakti. Let me take you word by word. Keneshitam patati preshitam manaha. Impelled by whom? Keneshitam means impelled or willed. By whom? Under whose direction the mana, the mind, falls on the object. Impelled by whom does my mind move towards an object? See, you perceive only through the senses and mind, isn't it? External perceptions. So who is it who is impelling my mind towards the object? That's the question. Look at the depth of the question. Then he says, kena prana prathama praiti yuktaha. This prana, this vital energy within me, one of whose expressions is the vital breath. This prathama, how does it proceed? The first, that is prana, how does it proceed? Impelled by whom does it proceed towards its goal? The breathing mechanism, how does it function? The vital energy, how is it performing its function? Impelled by what? Impelled by whom? So basically he is asking, how is this entire system functioning? What is the source of conscious perception? Then, keneshitam vachamimam vadanti. See, these senses, the vak is speech. So, impelled by whom do I speak? Chakshu shrotra kau devo yunakti. And directed by which god? Deva is actually luminous being. So directed by which luminous entity do my eyes and ears and speech and everything function? What is the source factor of perception? How does perception take place? See, aren't these very scientific questions? Tell me. Those of you who are studied, of course, today it's there even in the school textbooks, the epistemology of perception. How exactly do you perceive an object? And what are the factors involved? So this is what he is asking. What is the source also he is asking? What within me impels my senses to function as they are functioning, impels my vital energy to function and get directed as it is towards its function? You know, the vitality within you is responsible for all of the functions of your body, for all of the functions of your different organs. So, who is it who directs this vital energy, he is asking. And who is it who directs my mind towards the objects outside? So, you see, it's a very profound question that he is asking. The opening is like this, Kenopanishad. Tell me the source of conscious perception. How does this entire mechanism work? Now, the answer to this, you see, the next mantra is the answer to this inquiry. So, the next mantra goes like this. Shrotrasya shrotram manaso mano yat वाचोह वाचम सौ प्राणस्य प्राणः चक्षुश्च चक्षुर अतिमुच्य धीराः प्रेत्यास्मालोकाद् अमृता भवन्ति. लेट मी गो इन टू द वर्ड मीनिंग. श्रोत्रस्य श्रोत्रम, दिस ब्रह्मन इज द ईयर ऑफ द ईयर. मनसो मनोयत, इट इज द माइंड ऑफ द माइंड. इट इज एक्चुअली द रियल पावर बिहाइंड द माइंड एंड द सेंसेस. दिस इज वॉट ही इज सेइंग. यद वाचोह वाचम, दैट विच इज द स्पीच ऑफ द स्पीच. इट्स द रियल पावर बिहाइंड द ऑर्गन ऑफ स्पीच. सो प्राणस्य प्राणः, इट इज द ब्रेथ ऑफ द ब्रेथ. यू नो योर प्राण ऑल्सो, द एंटायर फंक्शनिंग ऑफ द प्राण, देर इज समथिंग बिहाइंड विच इम्पेल्स द प्राण टू डू दैट. दैट इज ब्रह्मन. एंड देन चक्षुश्च चक्षु, इट इज द आई ऑफ द आई. धीरा अतिमुच्य, सो द वाइज वन, the discriminating person, he gives up his wrong identity. And pretya asmad lokat amrita bhavanti, departing from this world he becomes immortal by gaining this knowledge of the source behind your entire system, the core truth about your personality. One who is able to intuit that, he gets liberated. This is what they are saying. Now we have to observe these mantras very carefully. See, unless this question comes, pops up in your own mind by yourself, you will not find these answers striking, let me tell you. Because first of all, the relevance of the question must come into our system. Don't we have these questions? Tell me how exactly this mechanism is working, and what is the core truth? Where does consciousness lie? How is it that my mind starts functioning? See, when you get up first thing in the morning, what happens? You open your eyes and you become aware. And then you become aware of things around you. But then gradually your sense of identity comes back. And then you start identifying with things and the thought process starts immediately. So, what they are trying to tell you is, there is something behind your thought process. Mind is nothing but a bundle of thoughts. But your awareness is more fundamental to the thought process, because you can study thought objectively. You can stop thought, isn't it? For a few fractions of a second, you can stop your thought process. With the practice of meditation, longer periods of time, you can stop your thought. And yet you remain over. You are always there as awareness, and thoughts come and go, move in and out of that awareness. And besides this, you are always objectively aware of your thought. That's why you have memories. So thought itself, the mind itself, is an object to whom? Who is the being to whom even thoughts are objects? You are aware of the presence of thought, you are aware of the absence of your thought process also, isn't it? See, deep sleep, no thoughts, you know it. So who is it who is aware of the presence of the thought process, the absence of the thought process, the stalling of the thought process, the functioning of the thought process? So obviously you are separate from the thought process. In fact, everything about this system is like that. You know, it is objective to you. If I raise my hand, I know I have raised this hand. The hand does not know me. I am aware of my hand being raised. The hand is not aware of me. Which means, what does this mean? Ponder and see. Right now you have to do it. Think and see. I am aware of my hand. My hand is not aware of me. It means, I am separate from the body. In my awareness, I perceive the hand, and I am that awareness. This is a perfect object of my perception. So also everything else, the entire body is an object of your study. That is what medical science is about. The entire mind is an object of your perception, of your study. That is what psychological sciences are about. So this entire system is objective to your being. So then who's the subject? See, please check this out and see. I hope I'm not going very fast. You must find the reality of this in your own system. I'm telling you again, this is no philosophy, this is no faith based something. It's an inquiry into the nature of your existence. You must conduct it right now in you, in yourself. Check and see, this entire equipment is objective to me. So then who's the subject? You will find only that pure I am-ness, existence, which is of the nature of awareness, pure awareness, is the subject. This I am, am-ness, being, this is the actual reality about you. Thought, emotion, will, perceptions, mentations, they are all external to your awareness. Once you close in on this, once you understand this in the first person, obviously what will you do? You will learn to deepen this awareness. You will learn to see it for what it is. I am pure being. Is my real unchanging nature. Always, always unchanging. The only thing unchanging in life is pure awareness, which you are. So this is what they are telling you. And this is the source of this entire mechanism. Everything borrows awareness and appears illumined. See your senses, the glow in your eyes. It is actually the light of awareness reflecting through your eye. The intelligence of your mind is actually the light of awareness reflecting through your mental apparatus. It is using the brain as a template, physical template to manifest. Because brain also in all these sciences is considered part of body. But essentially it is your mind. The clearer it is the mind, the better it will reflect the light. So the source of this entire mechanism, the senses, the mind, the body is pure awareness, consciousness, its universal aspect, it's called Brahman. This is the core truth of existence, the unchanging substratum of life. It is present as Atman within you. When you think of it as within you, and because you have a concept of yourself as an individual, then you call it the Atman. So this is the truth about you, unchanging truth about you. In so many ways you can go into this. You know, today's youngsters, they like to ask questions about this. Questions are like this. Well, how do you know that this Atman exists? Medically you have not found it. Or even your vital energy, you will not find it physically because it's in the pranamaya kosh. It is not in the annamaya kosh. You will not find the chakras because they are in the pranamaya kosh. What to speak of the Atman? That is the very source of your awareness. So you will not find it physically. But in awareness, you think through the thought process, you know you have a body, you perceive a world of objects, and using that physical equipment, now you are trying to see awareness. How will you find it? That is why the method to find it is meditation, turning the equipment inward and applying inquiry in a very pointed intellect. Drishyate tvagraya buddhaya sukshmaya sukshmadarshibhi, the Kathopanishad says, which means a very refined, pure intelligence turned inward will give you a sense of the self, the Atman within you. It is ever present, never absent. Mind may be present or absent. If you are unmindful, you see, where is the mind? You know, why is it that the Upanishad says awareness does not belong to mind, Atman is separate, mind-body complex is separate? It is only for this reason that your mind can be conscious, subconscious, unconscious. So awareness obviously cannot belong to the mind. It is borrowed from somewhere. Isn't it? Don't you experience all these states where it is full of dense thought. It is just half conscious, you know, in a dazed, sleepwalking state, sort of, you think, when it's very tamasic. But when it is okay, relatively better, then you think through a thought process. It may still be erratic thought. When you are in a very sattvic state, it's full of awareness. It reflects awareness best, because there is clarity there. So you see, you are capable of different degrees of reflection of this awareness. So that is why this awareness is not a property of your mind. It is borrowed from somewhere. That source factor is called the Atman, the unchanging self. And the mind reflects it in various ways. The clearer you keep your mind, the more intelligence will sparkle there. Please see this. So the way to increase your intelligence is to develop sattva, not to gather more information. Google is there to give you information always, but to become more and more sattvic. The more you remove the density of your mind, the more your intelligence will sparkle there. And with this buddhi turned inward, you will be able to intuit the Atman. So in all these ways, they are trying to tell us the real nature of your being. See, this mantra which we just went into, Shrotrasya Shrotram Manaso Manoyat Vachoha Vacham, how profound it is. The Atman, the source of your perception, is the very ear of your ear, they are telling you. Because that which enables your ear to hear, it is the Atman. And it is the mind of your mind. It is due to the presence of Brahman within you as the Atman that your mind becomes conscious, and conscious perceptions become possible. Thought becomes possible. So the source is the same. Vachoha vacham, speech becomes possible. So pranasya pranaha, it is the very vitality of your vital energy, the Atman. Atman is the source of even your vital energy. You know, many of these Upanishads deal with this word prana. They will say prana is satyam, it is the truth about life. But Atman is satyasya satyam, it is the truth of this truth. It is the ultimate truth of life. So try to understand, they are tracking the source of conscious perception, thought, mentation. They are tracking the very source. Then chakshushcha chakshu atimuchya dhira, it is the very eye of the eye, that which enables the eye to function. Again, it's the Atman. So this is how they are seeing it. And one who knows this, by giving up his false identification with this body-mind complex as being himself, now he knows the source of this entire mechanism is the Atman, the self. So he will identify there and use this as an instrument. Such a one, pretya asmad lokat amrita bhavanti, he attains the highest immortality when he departs from this world, which means to say self-realization gives you the ultimate liberation. It is only knowledge, this ultimate knowledge, the knowledge of Brahman, that gives you ultimate liberation. So, understanding the very source of our being will liberate the mind completely. Knowledge, that is why, you know, in the Bhagavad Gita it is said, Nahi jnanena sadrisham pavitram iha vidyate. There is nothing more purifying than knowledge. But who understands this? Tatsvayam yoga samsiddha kalena atmani vindati. One who has become yoga samsiddha, one who has reached the culmination of yoga, he realizes this immediately. The value of knowledge, the value of this level of knowledge will become very clear to him when he has become established in yoga. So you see the profundity of these mantras. I am telling you, these are no ordinary verses, mantras. They are born of realization. Otherwise, you cannot penetrate like this, isn't it? Many times, you know, when even logically our Many of our youngsters try to understand this. Many of my students do this. Logically, they are trying to understand many of these concepts. But I always tell them, you apply your logic, apply all of your thinking powers. Along with that, practice some amount of sadhana, spiritual discipline. And you will understand, oh my God, these mantras are really magic. I don't mean to say they are magical. I mean to say they are capable of transforming your entire being. This is the transformation that Vivekananda actually wanted. That is why he wanted all young people should absolutely study the Upanishads. You will understand everything through this. Now, if I ask you, well, to put it logically, if I tell you, well, what is the proof you have eyes? You will tell me, Mataji, the fact that I am seeing proves that I have eyes. What is the proof you have ears? I am hearing, that is proof I have ears. Now, what is, if you are having conscious perceptions, that must be proof of what? Think and see. Seeing means I have eyes. Hearing means I have ears. Smelling means I have a nose. Conscious perceptions means I have consciousness. Somewhere within me there is a unit of consciousness. There is a source factor which enlivens this entire system from within. And that is how I hear, I see, I know, I think, I feel. So this source of your entire conscious perception is the Atman, the self of the nature of pure consciousness. So you see, these mantras are pointing out to that in a very profound way. I am not going to hurry through Kenopanishad because these mantras are very, very important for you to understand. Let me also tell you one thing. When you actually, this comes in the third mantra. Let's just enter the third mantra and then we will go to your questions for this session. See, the third mantra is going to give you this idea. Na tatra chakshur gachati, na vag gachati, na manaha, na vidmo na vijanimo, yathaita danu shishyat. This na tatra chakshur gachati, which means these eyes, they cannot go there. Where the heart of reality is, where Brahman is, they cannot go there. Now vag gachati, this faculty of speech also cannot go there. Na manaha, this mind also cannot go there. Na vidmo na vijanimo, that's why we do not know how this can be taught by a teacher to a disciple. Yathaita danu shishyat, how this can be transmitted or made known, we do not know that. Because it is beyond the ambit of speech, sense, mind. Sense, by sense I mean sense organs and mind. It is beyond the ken of all of this. So what are they trying to tell us here? The eye, the speech, the mind, none of these are going to reveal the self to you. Because it is the source of all of these. Tasya bhasa sarvamidam vibhati. In the Kathopanishad, it is very beautifully said, it is due to the luminosity of the Atman. Here the luminosity is that of awareness, consciousness, that this entire equipment gets illumined from within. So these cannot, and these are so structured, they can observe outer objects, but they cannot observe what is inside. So then what is the way? Turn them inward. Turn them inward. Turn the mind inward. Because this knowledge cannot be got through the senses or the mind. It is far beyond that. So very important mantra again this is. The method to get the knowledge of the self is being told to you. You cannot teach self-knowledge through words. It is something that has to happen in your system. you can catch it through a powerful guru, through a powerful teacher, and it can be transmitted. The flame of light within the teacher can bring you some idea, clarity regarding this. It can give you an intuition of the actual thing. But the realization should come into your system by yourself. Knowing the Atman means becoming the Atman, isn't it? Brahmavid Brahmaiva Bhavati. It's your own, it's not your consciousness. You, the consciousness, will know yourself fully when you turn this entire equipment inward. So please remember, the body-mind complex is the instrument through which you function in this world. Now, if you give the instrument all importance and never think of the source factor, what kind of intelligence is that? Our sense of identity, where is it invested? A little bit you should think about it. If it's only invested in the body, you know, you will have only a very material existence here. Your very goals will be only material. If your sense of identity is at least invested in your mind, you will have intellectual goals in life. But when your sense of identity is with your being, pure awareness, obviously your entire equipment, you are using it to turn inward, your goals will be spiritual. Your very purpose in life will be primarily spiritual. So actually the Upanishads say that those who are only committed to, you know, body consciousness, they are atmahanaha, they are suicides, because they have lost touch with the reality of their being. You must know, you must give things the importance they deserve. Living merely on the plane of body consciousness and mind, or even just silly thought, does not befit the human experience. For the simple reason, your own being is by its very nature of the nature of consciousness, spirit, Brahman. You are verily Brahman. So these are all mechanisms to turn you towards your very source. So this is the Keno Upanishad, very powerful. Now let me go to your questions. The questions have come to me, and it is important to do this question answer session because so many people want to interact, and I'm so sorry that I don't get time to answer your calls or answer mails and in whatever way you're sending messages. So that's why we started this question answer session, so that here at least we have a platform for one-to-one interaction. You can put your questions, as many as it is possible to answer every session. For about 15-20 minutes, I will be taking up that. So the first question for today is, in Bhagavad Gita, we find purification of mind and buddhi. What is purification of mind and buddhi? How can we attain this in practical ways? Yes, very important question. Everywhere you will find this in our scriptural literature. Even if you read Ramakrishna Vivekananda literature, you will find this. The purification of mind and buddhi is the most important thing to get this level of knowledge. Otherwise, you know, your mind and buddhi will only remain busy with silly external things. Once you scrutinize the nature of mere sense experience, you will understand the validity of doing this, the importance of doing it. So how do you practically achieve this clarity of mind and buddhi? Let me give you steps to do this. First of all, as I always insist, a sattvic life, that is real intelligence, I'll tell you. If you lead a tamasic life, you will become dim. Although you may think you are very intelligent, it's nothing but ego, but you will actually become dim. If you, having been born as a human being, if you sleep for 10 hours a day, you are wasting a huge part of your life. So get out of tamas. If it is difficult to do it, you must apply willpower. I told you, do anusankalpas every day, work on it, get out of tamas, and at least a large amount of sattva should come into your life. You will see naturally the mind is getting very clear. So the practical steps to a sattvic life are again very clear, fixed kind of disciplined life, getting up early in the morning, because those are the most important hours. If you can get a Brahma Muhurta, excellent. If you can't, at least dawn you should be up, isn't it? How can you waste your mornings, tell me? And then your periods of sleep, periods of eating your food, all these should be minimized. You will see the energy that grows in your system, the clarity that comes to your mind. So regulating life through self-discipline, exercising your body and mind every day, proper good holy exposures, no nonsense. See, a spiritual aspirant's life is a no nonsense life. Just if you expose your senses to just anything, you know, you can delete it on your whatever, your laptop or your phone. You cannot delete it so easily from your mind once it becomes a sanskar, because your vrittis, when you repeat them, they become sanskars. There's no delete button there. There's no undo. You have to again work and work to remove those sanskars. So don't, in the first place, become so alert, so committed, that you won't gather the wrong impressions, the wrong sanskars. This is very important for a sattvic life. See, these are the practical steps. Then regulating your food habits. Eat clean sattvic food. And keeping good company as far as possible. I always tell you this, holy elevating company. Practicing discipline at all these levels, and especially not an overindulgent life. Control of the senses. Control of sexual desires. Brahmacharya. You don't know the power of brahmacharya. It is the key to success. If you just follow it as it should be followed, every day you will feel you are in a fresh body. It is the whole body and the mind become so pure. And once you understand the value of it, you will understand the value of human life. The beauty of human life. Your entire energies are in your hands. So this all of this generates purity in the system. Try to live this type of life for some time and see the level of clarity it will bring to your intelligence, to your mind, the sparkle it will bring on your face. I mean, the beauty it will bring on your face and your senses, and the body will remain healthy. You will have an air of purity around you. So it is perfectly possible. You must understand the importance of it, and then you will go into it naturally. Create the home atmosphere, the ambience to manufacture this level of a pure life. And then you know your sadhana will work wonderfully for you. The essential thing in spiritual life is the attainment of purity, not mere concentration. Please remember this. If you have a pure mind, you will concentrate it on the right things. If you have an impure mind, you will concentrate it on the wrong things and fall into greater trouble. So concentration is not merely the key to success. It is basic inner purity, commitment to core values, higher values of life. So this is the answer to your first question. I have given you a number of practical tips. See if you can follow them. Why has Atman chosen to express itself through many? How does the subtle express itself through the gross? Okay. Why has he chosen to express himself through many? You know, there's a hymn in Rig Veda, Nasadiya Suktam. So far back then, Rig Veda is more than 8,000 years old. So there you will find this mentioned. Why the one Brahman, one consciousness wanted to express itself as the many? Because you see, in devotional language, it's called Leela. to taste the beauty of life in various ways. It seems he felt like sort of alone, isolated, and he desired to become many, so he appeared as many. It's the same consciousness appearing through different names and forms, through different bodies and minds, under different names. So we appear to be different. The core reality is the same. So you see, the play of life and the color of life lies in difference, isn't it? So that is why Brahman chose to manifest in different ways. It is manifestation, please remember. This is a world of manifestation. How does the subtle express itself as gross? Subtle only expresses itself as gross and not vice versa. You know, always it is energy that expresses itself through something. So even, you see, what is it that expresses through your body? Your mind, your attitudes, your emotions, isn't it? They will come on your face whether you like it or not. They will come as the light in your eyes. So the whole point is, always the subtle within you will express itself through the gross. This is the niyam, the law of the universe. So the subtler you become, the more the manifestation will be pure, holy, sattvic, good. Isn't it? Today, across many universities, they are having leadership workshops, okay? Because it's such an important idea. Even across management studies, even here one university is actually creating a workshop on, a course on leadership based on Karma Yoga principles. Now, why is it that leadership is such an important idea? For the simple reason, you want to be able to handle other minds effectively. This capacity will only come if you are able to handle your own mind effectively. And that is why self-knowledge is so important. If I don't know my own being, how will I handle my mind? If I can't handle my mind, how will I handle others' minds? I will not even know. So the very basic principle of leadership is, you don't become a leader by trying to become a boss. You become a leader when you touch the core of your being. You will become a natural leader. Because your mind has come into your hands, other minds will realize this. So remember, always the subtle will manifest as the gross. This is the law. What is the relationship between Brahman, Ishvara and Maya? If Maya is created by us, how should we manifest the blessings of God? Well, the relationship between Brahman is the ultimate reality of the universe, which the Vedas speak of. When it is reflected from the cosmic mind, it gives you a sense of a personal being who is called Ishvara, God. The cosmic principle of pure being expresses itself as the God whom we worship. And what is Maya? Maya is some kind of an illusory force which obscures reality, creates illusions in the Jiva, not in Ishvara. In the Jiva, Maya obscures the reality or the truth of Brahman. So now you are asking, if Maya is created by us, the whole problem is, see, practically how this works is, if the buddhi is not clear enough, you will fall into the trap of Maya. It takes various forms, Maya, as attachment, as desire, lust, anger, hatred, well, so many things. But essentially it is a covering over your buddhi. So there is a cosmic aspect of it also, an illusory force which obscures reality. Now to get rid of this, that is why sadhana. That is why we don't manifest the blessings of the Almighty, as you are saying. Although the blessings are ever there, we can't taste them, we can't manifest them, because the buddhi, initially the intellect, is wrapped in maya. So that this knowledge which we are discussing, the Upanishadic knowledge, helps us clear this maya so that we see reality as it is. If you want to know the tattva, the actual definition of these entities which you are asking about, Ishvara, Jiva, Maya, please read that book which I told you, Hinduism at a Glance by Swami Nirvedananda. These ideas will be very clear. Then you will understand how the Jiva gets trapped in Maya and hence is not able to get this knowledge. So the consequences, suffering, ignorance. So that is why the study of Upanishad then becomes very important to help us overcome this Maya. Because we are thinking beings. Through the medium of knowledge, you can penetrate into the reality of your being. So this is the answer. The fourth question is, Bhagavad Gita mentions karma, akarma. What is the difference between them? How can we implement them in our daily lives? So this is a very big question actually. So Bhagavad Gita tells us this, that the wise see karma as akarma and akarma as karma. And then what is the difference? See, that is called karma, which generates when you're doing something with a sense of agentship and capable of yielding fruit, a karma phal, then you call it a karma, an act which has a definite result. Now you know, when a person with self-knowledge performs karma, his eye is not on the result. As a result, it becomes a karma for him. It becomes a karma yoga for him. It is a liberating factor. But for somebody who doesn't have this knowledge, you know, he may not be consciously doing something, but anything he does will generate karma and karma phal. Although he may not want it. So that is why karma and akarma can work like this. The essential thing is to awaken to the depths of your own being, to become more and more conscious of your own true self. Then what will happen? This equipment will become very conscious. So you will do the right thing always. You will not be under your compulsions. You will not lead an impulsive life. As a result, when you do the right thing, you will have only positive effect result, isn't it? So the karma phal will always work for you. You will only do good. But if you have awakened within, then otherwise you go on blundering through life. Haven't you seen people like this? They are only half conscious. They are like really like sleepwalking. And even if something they do wrong, say something, some rubbish, they don't mind it. Because they are not even conscious of the consequences. So you will go on blundering through life if you do not become deeply conscious. That is why the only final remedy to all of our problems is not mere mind management, but self-knowledge. Awaken yourself to your own true being. You can handle the equipment perfectly, the mind, the senses, your faculty of speech, everything will be in place, it will be under you. So then whatever karma you perform, whatever karma phal you generate will be only positive. It will only bring good to yourself and to the world. So this is the importance of karma and akarma. Please read the Bhagavad Gita. I am so happy to see your questions are from the scriptures. How can I maintain being righteous when I am surrounded by others who are unethical? I tend to lose the battle when I find the latter being rewarded for their outcomes. So you will not lose the ultimate battle, please remember. It may appear that they are being rewarded or whatever for their unethical practices. Sometimes you see this happens in life. But it's for a short time. See, the law of karma, nobody can escape this law. It's inexorable. It's infallible. Nobody can escape it. And remember this, but through good karma you can modify bad karma. So if you are, you maintain your ethical principles and somebody, your whoever colleague is not doing it, you just maintain your inner integrity by yourself. Don't bother about what he got, what he did not get, whether he got rewards for it or got punished for it. What does it matter to you? You will stick to the core values of your life. And if you see injustice happening in these ways, that the wrongdoer is getting rewarded, then of course you can voice your opinion. But don't invest your energies too much in this. Voicing our opinion, righteous indignation is good and has to be done, especially when you are in a society. But if you invest all of your energies into this, you know, you will get jaded. Why is this happening? It's only a brief thing. You know, no injustice in the world is final, or it's the final thing for the person. He will meet his karma. What you sow, that you are going to reap. And it's only a question of time before he reaps it. You know, in unknown, unforeseen ways, the effects come. So, in our own personal lives, there must be absolute commitment to righteous conduct, to a very integrated life, to high level discipline and higher knowledge. Then what is happening around us will not affect us. This is very important for you to remain integrated, you know. Otherwise, you will get mixed up. For a long time, if you keep seeing, are, isne ye karke bhi, isne ye paya, you will sort of get mixed up. You will get diluted in your commitments. So take care of this. There are certain things, the core values of life, which you have to absolutely stand firm upon. And please decide what those core values will be. Maybe sometime in the course of these lectures, we will discuss them. Today, time is up. I would like to end the class here. I want to make an announcement before I end. See, next 2 weeks, we are not going to have this class because I am traveling. We will have the next class only on 10th October. From time to time, I have to go to our Himalayan centers for giving retreats. So, I will be making such announcements. Please bear with us. Next 2 weeks, we will not have these classes. The next class will start on 10th October, the session number 2 of Keno Upanishad, and then we will continue. Thank you very much. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.